Good evening, everyone. We'll go ahead and get started. I am Jennifer Meehan, the new Director of Special Collections here at the Library of Congress, and it is my pleasure to welcome you all to the last event of today, a day that has been celebrating the collections of the Geography and Map Division, our staff, and you, our supporters. In my role here, a new one for me at the library, I have the privilege of working with a stellar team of colleagues to build, steward, and engage with the library's unparalleled special collections. This work centers on facilitating discovery, learning, and creativity by connecting people to the truly rare, unique, and distinctive collections here at the library, which include rare books, manuscripts, music, and maps, and so much more. Geography and Map is notably one of the first special collections here at the library, and it is the largest map collection in the world, with more than 5 million examples spanning almost the entire history of map making. Many of you, members of the Philip Lee Phillips Society and those in the Washington Map Society, are amongst our strongest supporters, and for decades you've participated in building these amazing collections. We truly and sincerely thank you for all that you have done. The Washington Map Society members, who we especially welcome here tonight, also form the heart of a community of scholars, collectors, and cartographers that gives life to these amazing collections and also plays a vital role with us in unlocking these treasures and sharing them with all people everywhere. So I want to personally, and on behalf of the library, welcome you back to the Library of Congress, both those here in person tonight as well as connecting with us online. It is symbolic that tonight's talk focuses on a historic and important map exchange program here at the library that for several decades enhanced local and university map collections around the world. So to kick us off, it is my great pleasure to introduce Jeff Katz, president of the Washington Map Society. Jeff.
Thank you very much, Jennifer, for giving that perspective on special collections and the role of maps, something I think we all appreciate. And it is a special pleasure for me and those of us in the Washington Map Society to be joining at the library for a first live lecture that we have had in several years, and the first live one we've had here also in several years. So that is a special pleasure for us, and I'm very pleased to tell you all, for those who don't know, that the library and the Washington Map Society have a long and deep connection. The very first president of the Map Society, Walter Ristau, and co-founder of the Map Society, was also the chief at the time of the Geography and Map Division. I'd like to turn over the podium here to Ron Grimm, who will introduce our speaker and moderate our conversation for the evening. Thank you very much.
In consultation with the other MAP societies, we have developed a program schedule through the beginning of January. As I've indicated before, the list of programs is indicated or is published in the most current issue of the portal, and I have circulated that list to the other MAP societies. The next combined Zoom meeting for the MAP societies is scheduled for Wednesday, is scheduled for Wednesday, November 30, starting at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. It will feature Thomas Horst, who will be joining us from Lisbon, Portugal. That means he's going to be up at midnight while we're here at 7. He is a postdoctoral researcher at Lisbon University, where he studies cosmographic knowledge visualized on maps, globes, and texts, as well as transcultural relations in the early modern period. I had the pleasure of having him as my co-editor of the book reviews for Imago Mundi for the last 10 or so years. And he is also a contributor to ISIS on the history of cartography entries. Now, his presentation will be timed to coincide with the 60th anniversary of the restitution of the Bavarian Army Library to Germany. Now, you ask, what does that have to do with us here in Washington, D.C., and here at the Library of Congress? Well, following World War II, the Bavarian Army Library's map collection was taken by the U.S. Army and was brought to the United States. And for at least a decade, it was stored here at the Library of Congress. But we've scheduled the presentation on the 30th of November, which is 60 years since it was returned back to Germany. So I hope you will join us for that presentation, which I think will reflect an interesting part of our history. And tonight, I'd like to introduce our guest speaker, Laura McElfresh. She is the cartographic metadata librarian at the University Libraries, the University of Minnesota. The title of her presentation is Will Work for Maps, a history of the Library of Congress Geography Map Division Special Map Processing Project. It is based on a recent journal article that she co-authored with Paige Andrews and Linda Musser, and it appeared in a recent issue of the Journal of Map and Geography Libraries. Since we are celebrating the Geography and Map Division today, I think it is particularly appropriate that we look at this period of history, almost a little more than 50 years from about the end of World War II up until the early 20th century, looking at one of the defining projects of the Geography and Map Division. I won't say any more about the project. I will let Laura tell you about that. Now, before I turn the program over to Laura, I would like to thank the five individuals listed on the screen for helping to support the fact that we could bring Laura to Washington, D.C. for this first in-person presentation. And Laura, now I turn the program over to you.
Where did my phone go? Yes.
My notes are on that.
Thank you for that introduction, Ron. It is an honor and a pleasure to be here speaking with y'all at the first in-person meeting that you've had apparently in several years. Thank you very much to the program sponsors who helped to bring me here, and I hope you enjoy it. All right, so as Ron said, the program is Will Work for Maps, a history of the Library of Congress Geography and Map Division Special Map Processing Project, based on the article that we recently published. The first time I talked about this topic was at the WAML 2020 virtual conference. It was about 2 years ago. And since then, we have also produced a poster for the Federal Depository Library Conference. And the article was published in 2021 in the 2020 volume of Journal of Map and Geography Libraries. I started as a serials cataloger, so squirrely publication years will never, ever not amuse me. I just need to make a quick note on terminology, and let me pull it back there. You okay? For the presentation, The formal name that we found was the LCGNM Special Map Processing Project. People called individual iterations, so a particular year would be called the Summer Projects. And less frequently, we also saw it called the Summer Program or the Special Program. So in the aggregate, there is that whole long formal name, sometimes the project for short with a capital P. But I might use terminology somewhat interchangeably here, but we just wanted the title to be stated accurately for once. So right here, we've got a couple of samples of how GNM would indicate that a map was a surplus, and then they would be made available through the exchange program. You may have some of these people who work in map libraries in your collection. Minnesota has some. I haven't seen any personally yet. But the article was part of a special issue of JMGL called That Map Belonged to Somebody, The Importance of Provenance for Map Librarians. So the stamps that we see here sort of tie the research that Paige and Linda and I did to the theme of that issue. They show the provenance of the individual maps. But we can also think about the importance of the provenance of map librarians, which ties the research in the article to the theme today, Explore Geography and Map Division. Now, as far as I know, the people didn't get stamped, although folks get all kinds of tattoos these days. But we explored not only how the summer projects not only seeded map collections across the US and slightly beyond, there were a couple up in Canada as well, but it was also something of a nursery for map librarianship. In particular, the participants gained experience with the technical services aspects of map librarianship, description and arrangement, and they brought that knowledge home with them in addition to the surplus maps that they took. So, in the late 1940s and into the 1950s, GNM had a problem. They were amassing maps faster than they could deal with them. There were a lot of military maps and other maps coming in after World War II. And it eventually built up to at least an estimated 750,000 of unprocessed maps, probably closer to the whole million. So yes, I would bet that I know that there are a few map catalogers here in the audience, maybe some others who work in tech services, but we face down big backlogs all the time. And there are all hands on deck projects sometimes just to get things done because, you know, a not so complete record is better than just having something sit in essentially a closet. But that is just what Arch Gerlach, I hope I pronounced that correctly, I've only seen it written. The chief of the division in 1950, he proposed that GNM do something along exactly those lines. He went to Librarian of Congress and he requested and was granted authorization to hire geography graduate students on a temporary basis in the summer of 1951. And this became the first special map processing project. Contingent on the success of that program, it became an annual and then it kind of tapered out to biennial or triennial program. So now this map here is not an actual map from the duplicate surplus exchange, although someone very may well have a copy. But it's kind of representative of the type of maps that participants would be bringing home, military maps that the Library of Congress received after World War II. So the inaugural Special Map Processing Project had 8 graduate students on temporary hire with LC. We do not know, I don't believe, where those graduate students were from, but the volunteers came from Columbia, Illinois, Wisconsin, and the American Geographical Society of New York. So the report of the Librarian of Congress, one of our biggest sources for this research project, indicates that a summer project was set up for the sorting and processing of maps held in dead storage. 8 graduate students were employed for 90 days, and help was obtained from the American Geographical Society of New York, Columbia University, the University of Illinois, and the University of Wisconsin in exchange for duplicate maps. With this aid, 9,612 new maps were accessioned, 7,807 sheets were indexed, 2,960 new maps were filed, and 7,004 duplicate maps were stockpiled for exchange distribution. This little paragraph is all that appeared in the report of the Librarian of Congress. Those were one of our big sources, but those sections in the Librarian of Congress report came from a more extensive report that the GNM chief would contribute each year. Those are unpublished. The only way that we were able to get to them housed here in Library of Congress was that Ed Redmond helped us out, and we owe him a great debt of gratitude. He scanned and sent us the copies, and we were able to go through and get the numbers and the names and the history that we needed. So now, coming back to those four people who came in as volunteers, they did work in exchange. They were paid in being able to take home duplicate surplus maps, and they were called cooperative or co-op participants. So qualified librarians, faculty members, or graduate students, I think there were a couple of undergrads, but mostly graduate students, were accepted as cooperative participants. The sponsoring institutions were responsible for paying their salary at that time that they were away on this work project, for costs incurred in shipping the materials home, for their living expenses, and the support in that manner. Now, during some of the years of the project into the 70s, materials were franked, so the Congress member from that person's home state would give them the ability to send maps home at no cost. That definitely had an effect on the selection process. But at some point, it did revert to institutions having to pay the shipping. Project members were assigned to work with permanent staff members at LC on various tasks related to technical processing and bibliographic and reference services. So in addition to the experience and the networking that they gained by working in a large research map library with highly qualified professionals, participants also got to select maps, charts, atlases, even some globes from available duplicate stocks to bring them home. Okay, here we go, start actually getting to look at some maps. In the early years, it was a mix of paid and cooperative participants. And I've got the home locations from 1951 to 1965. That is a kind of an odd selection of years. I wanted to be able to do the first 10 years, but the depth of available information was really, really variable. I had to go out to 15 years in order to be able to get 5 years worth of geodata to make a map there. The early participants were mostly geography students. We didn't have a whole lot of librarians yet. Participants were mostly from the East Coast and the Midwest, and mostly the northern and middle U.S. latitudes, not a whole lot at all in the West and the South, though you can see Seattle and a couple down there in Southern California. This only shows the co-op participants, not the paid participants, because for part of our project, we were looking at where the maps were going. So this kind of shows us that. We do look at all participants in a moment, though. So the project got started in 51. By 19 years later, it was in full swing. We can't really necessarily call it the heyday, but it was going. There were large project cohorts. It was expanding the reach of its participant pool, and lots and lots and lots of maps got sent out on exchange. Here are some of the nice folks, and you can see a bin there in the 1983 picture with just boxes of maps that folks were taking home. They're not in chronological order. It wouldn't fit nice that way, but I just arranged them to show you the group pictures from 1981, 82, 83, 79, 75, and 76. During this time period, there was an increase in professionalization of the project, sort of. Instead of none of them were really rudimentary, one can't really say. Map processing here in the earlier days of map cataloging was sometimes the only identification and description that a map would get. It would have a title, it would have some kind of subject matter indicated on it, some kind of a call number for a way to find it, and that might just be it. But map cataloging experienced also a boom during this time. And so we started having more librarians come in and be able to contribute knowledge that they already had of librarianship. So there was a transition from mostly grad students and some librarians to mostly librarians with a handful of grad students. According to the 1976 GNM annual report, GNM never promoted the projects as training sessions. Nonetheless, they have come to be so regarded, and in recent years, participants have included an increasingly large percentage of full or part-time map librarians. The complexity of their work increased. It included incorporation of computerized cataloging work and preparation of existing analog cataloging for computerization. 1972 was the last year that Library of Congress paid any participants. As of 1973, the project was all co-op. And here's how that breaks down. The cohort sizes at the beginning were kind of all over the place. There was a big one, then a couple of little ones, and it jumps all over the place. For the years that we have numbers, we didn't always. And if we didn't have the number, we just left it blank. But then in the late 70s and early 80s, it started a final downward trend. I'm sorry, I should have made it clear that the first color on the map that I show in the legend, the gold, it shows up to me, is we only had a single figure. We don't know if they were co-op or paid. Then the blue, the second color in the legend, that is participants that Library of Congress supported. And the magenta is co-op. You can see how in that trail off tail towards the end, it was all co-op. And so we come to the time when it was sort of trailing off. As reported in Baseline in February of 1984, there would not be a 1984 summer program because first there were not enough maps and atlases for individuals to select. They did, however, expect to resume it the next year. There had been 1 year previously without a project, and that was 1980 because at the time, GNM was too busy moving over here into the Madison building. Then the 1984 project was canceled because there weren't enough maps to go around. They had projects in 81, 2, and 3. They had one in 85, as was promised. But then they skipped 86, 87, and 89. So up until 1979, they were very nearly annual. No, they were annual up till then, I'm sorry. The first one skipped was 80. And then they were very nearly annual through the mid-80s. Starting up in 1988, they were less frequent. There's no word for 2.5 annual, but they were somewhere between bi and triennial. I should not have said that. As a former serials cataloger, I'm afraid I just spoke it into existence. And now some journal's gonna do that. So the project tapered off by the 1990s, and it had its last official iteration in 2003. I wasn't able to find a picture from 2003, but we do have 2001, the penultimate one. There was never, as far as we know, an official declaration that the project was over. However, we do know that in 2011, when Director Ehrenberg returned from retirement, the division considered holding a project, but then they chose not to. There were three main reasons cited. First of all, LC was no longer raking in those stockpiles of duplicates. They had been coming mainly after World War II, remember, so there just weren't as many coming in. And academic libraries weren't raking them in either. They were shifting from physical maps to digital ones. Then finally, Library of Congress had started its library-wide Junior Fellows program, which was a paid summer internship for college undergraduates. It was founded in 1991, and then by the mid-2000s, they had interns everywhere all over the library, including some ones that we see here from GNM. There were four grad students, undergrad students. We only have pictures of three of them, unfortunately. And they worked on sorting nautical charts for GNM. This is the last documented instance that Ian, Page, and Linda were able to find of a GNM summer project. It doesn't fall under the capital P project, but it was still summer work being done in that same vein. So due to budget cuts, there was no longer sufficient staffing at GNM to be handling two things, and priority went to the library-wide effort. I do wonder if those kids ever ended up working in libraries, or particularly map libraries, and I kind of hope they did. Which brings us around to the project's reach and impact on people, institutions, and collections. So, here we have it again, that bin, that like gym laundry bin full of boxes of maps. The average number of items that a participant took home after a project was 5,702. That's a lot of maps. University of Maryland took home 69,540 one year. But the typical large share was 20,000 or so. Appalachian State only had room for 586, but University of Illinois took home six globes out of a total of 18 in 1974. There were 1.25 million items that went out, all added up by 1976 estimated, 1.5 million by 1978, and 2 million over the whole entire program. So participants had 4 hours per week to select items. It was called, referred to as the Friday frenzies. Folks described it as you need a linebacker with map experience to go pick out your stuff because it's just like, it was like, I don't know, map supermarket sweep or something. People just grabbing whatever they could because the shipping was free. So grab what you can, sort it out later. If you don't want it, it'll get sent to somebody else, which is also a valid consideration because that's helping not only your institution, but it's helping the people who are getting the leftovers. So there's reach for this project that we weren't even able to account for. Not as impressive as the graphs we saw this afternoon, but I hope it's informative. So looking at all those maps that went out, they had a few go out the first couple of years, and then all of a sudden, bam, maps started going out like hotcakes. So the blue bars are official Library of Congress numbers that we got from some report or some Library of Congress publication. There were some that I was like, okay, well, if it was this number of maps in 1971, and they only had however many maps. Like if we were missing 1969, the number for it, but we had the numbers of totals for the 2 years surrounding it, we did a little math and made that a green bar. And then there were a couple that were completely unaccounted for, split them up and made them the yellow bars. And then a value of zero on that graph, no bar at all. That's years that no project took place. So we filled in some kind of a number on each year that we knew a project did happen to let y'all see how many maps were going out. So now a little while back, we saw the map from the first 15 years and it was almost all East Coast and Midwest, hardly anyone anywhere else either. So this map over the whole entire run of the project, again, co-ops, it's filled in a little bit. You can see that the middle of the country has had some participants. South and Southwest are filling in, so is Hawaii. And during the middle years of the project, it became all co-op anyway, so I think just looking at the co-op only is okay. This is a reuse of a previous map. Especially given that that's when the professionalization happened, and that from 1973 onward, it was all co-op anyway. Now, this just shows you which institutions participated. It doesn't show you how many times. There were definitely some repeat visitors, so now they're getting slightly bigger dots. And according to our count, which is only as complete as we could get it, we were missing a lot of numbers, the grand champion was Penn State with 15 repetitions at the project. Yeah. Indiana University and University of Kansas were both tied with 12. University of Illinois had 10. Minnesota has 4, which is not bad. The colors are just to distinguish them, help with visual separation a little bit, especially down there with the clusters in LA and San Diego and up along New Jersey. It doesn't help that down in Houston, though, because Rice and University of Houston, my two schools, they're 8 miles apart. There's not a whole lot I can do at this level. But now let's get some not visual separation. This is the map that we saw at the beginning when Ron was introducing it. So this heat map, based on repetitions, really brings out the East Coast and Midwest concentration. So this helps drive home the high concentrations of certain participant areas. And there was a little bit of conflict between Carlos Hagen and Walter Ristau about the program being a training program. Hagen was concerned that West Coast schools were left out entirely because it was hard to travel. And he also had a bone to pick about the content of the program. But looking at this map, we can see that by the end of the project, it had some reach on the West Coast, and even Hawaii had 2 different participating institutions. There was the Bernice Pauahi Bishop Museum in 1988, and BYU Hawaii was in 1996. I do have a weighted map of all participants. This comes from the article, and it's a weighted, another weighted one. And then one more map to show you. That's the same one, except for now I have colored it according to when the first year of known participation was. So the size of the dot shows how many times they sent someone, and the color shows how early they first got in on it. So the blue dots are now the ones who got in on early ones. So Seattle got in early. Los Angeles got in pretty early too. Then it kind of goes through light blue and green up until the later additions institutionally. This doesn't account for the distribution of participants over the course of an institution's tenure. So like we know that Indiana sent a bunch of people, but if you look at that dot, it's all blue. It doesn't tell you how many of them were earlier versus later, but there is, a limit to what I could do in 2 dimensions. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about the human impact of this project. GNM was never intending for the project to be a training session. However, they did come to be regarded as such. And as I mentioned just a moment ago, back in 1960 and 70, Carlos Hagen and Walter Ristau had a little bit of back and forth about whether the project was an internship or not, various other imperfections. And this all happened out in public in, oh goodness, I'm drawing a blank on what it was, but I can look it up, where they had letters to the editor going back and forth. They did. It was kind of contentious. But it did serve as a de facto career gateway. Over the years, several summer project participants did end up as map librarians, and a non-trivial number of participants' career paths brought them to GNM itself, right here. It also built and enhanced connections across the map librarianship community, and it helped facilitate not exactly networking, because it's the Library of Congress. Any network, it would pretty much sit at the center of it. But having the project, having these librarians coming in from all over the country, it helped them build communication and contacts, which GNM, being itself a very large special library, but many of its contemporaries, other map libraries, are academic institutions, it was helpful to them to have that communication groundwork laid. One of those people was Ed Redmond, and here in the middle we have a picture of him leading a tour. So they did try to beef up the project learning-wise and teaching-wise. The project itself provided exposure to and immersion in map library work. And I'm sure that it's this way for public services, people in libraries, and I can tell you for certain it's this way in tech services. You go to library school and get the theory of the work. You do your little group projects, your term projects, and get some idea of how to do this work, but then you really just learn it on the job. The only way you learn it is by doing it. There's too much local practice, too many little nuts and bolts to be conveyed in a classroom setting. So when people came up here and were working in a large research library, a large research map library, no less, assisting on projects, they were getting boots on the ground experience, which is invaluable. So they gained knowledge and experience in map series and sets, how to arrange those, issues relating to lack of storage, which that's not going away anytime soon, and just holistic observations of how a large map library works. But then, in addition to that, perhaps in part due to the Hagen-Ristau exchanges, they ramped up on the educational offerings. In the 60s, they started offering educational presentations on map librarianship, tours of other libraries and facilities. And they wanted to, as Ralph Ehrenberg described it, deal with specialized aspects of map librarianship and introduce participants to distinctive segments of the cartographic collection. So this slide shows you some of the topics that were covered in 1976 in the seminar series. They covered acquisitions, they covered MarkMap, which had just been coming out, if I recall correctly, the system for machine-readable map cataloging. They were looking at accessions, and then just history of cartography, things that maybe people were not getting in school, in library school. It can be rare to find those these days, even. And so, and yes, that does mean I am almost finished. That's how the project not only seeded map collections in libraries, but also the map librarians themselves. Our article was published in JMGL in the special issue. Here's all our bibliographic information. If you have access to that journal, you can get it there. Otherwise, it is available in preprint form via Penn State University's ScholarSphere, which you can get on that QR code. I know that writing down a URL is not something you should ask people to do. Anyway, no, I try at presentation. It's like, I'm not done yet. So QR code, little dino in the middle. There you go. So I would like to thank you for your attention. Thank also in absentia my co-authors, Paige Andrew and Linda Musser. Thank you to Ron and Jeff and everybody else for bringing me here.